La présentation du livre, ouvrage collectif, mais disons très, 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 très dirigé hein, par notre cher organisateur, José Muñoz. Politics and piety at the royal sites of the Spanish monarchy in the 17th century. L'ouvrage est paru dans une série à Brepols qui sera présentée un peu plus tard. Permettez-moi de vous dire l'importance de cet ouvrage parce que justement, les travaux récents sur les sites du pouvoir, les résidences des princes d'Europe, se sont concentrés sur les relations multiples entre espace et cérémonial. La matérialité de ces résidences et très souvent traite l'espace, donc l'espace sacré dans toute sa richesse, toute sa variété, de façon un peu secondaire, disons. Le sujet, évidemment, est extrêmement complexe. Il ne s'agit pas seulement de la chapelle ou, disons, presque église du château, nous sommes à Versailles, hein, où apparemment donc l'espace sacré numéro 5 dans l'histoire de la construction, qu'est-ce que vous m'avez dit, Benjamin, est vraiment à l'envergure d'une très grande église, hein, comme on voit de façon très, très claire en s'approchant de l'entrée principale. Il ne s'agit pas seulement donc de la chapelle du prince ou de mais également de l'église, très souvent sise dans la basse-cour, appartenant peut-être à un ordre monastique, etc. Ce sont les choses qu'on connaît le mieux, qu'on peut décrire avec l'outillage de l'historien de l'architecture et de l'art, si on veut bien. Mais à part cela, le réseau s'étend aux fondations, hein, tant funéraires qu'autres, promues par le prince, par ses relations, par sa cour, qui font partie du grand jeu de pouvoir dans toute sa complexité, qui détermine le prestige d'une famille, sa piété officielle, pietas, aspect très important dans l'Europe du Moyen Âge tardif et la première époque moderne, puisque les rois se concurrencient en portant des titres comme roi très chrétien, roi très catholique, et ainsi de suite. Et si nous élargissons notre perspective à l'Empire ottoman, évidemment, le sultan donne, mais de notre façon, dans la même chose, protecteur de la foi, ainsi dit. Ce qui veut dire que l'aspect ne peut être négligé, ni dans ses manifestations, disons, immatérielles, ni dans ses manifestations matérielles. Et enfin, nous avons un grand livre qui prend en charge ce sujet très, très complexe pour, eh bien oui, l'Empire Habsbourg, côté espagnol, mais également ancien Pays-Bas et les autres périphéries, disons, méditerranéennes surtout. En effet, géographiquement, on couvre plus la moitié de l'Europe hein, d'aujourd'hui, de la Sicile aux lointains confins nordiques de l'Empire, disons les Pays-Bas, Saint-Empire, avec quelques déviations par le Saint-Empire, et ainsi de suite. Grande gageure qui est très réussie, je dois vous dire, et qui lance un défi aux autres empires, Valois, Bourbon, etc., ou Danois même, hein, n'est-ce pas, Christophe? Pour reprendre donc ce challenge, donc ce défi, et d'étudier justement l'espace du pouvoir royal et princier de la même façon, donc de sa perspective, du point de vue religieux. Il s'agit non seulement des espaces matériels, immatériels, mais aussi des personnes et des institutions, couvents et autres. Et en effet, il faut faire preuve d'une grande maîtrise non seulement des court studies, études de la cour, mais aussi l'histoire, la religion, des ordres monastiques et ainsi de suite pour pouvoir s'attaquer à tel thème et Je vous salue absolument, Eloy, d'avoir réussi cela, même en écrivant pas mal de chapitres vous-même, mais Jonathan nous en dira plus sur le contenu, hein, les différents chapitres du livre. Donc, je vous passe tout de suite la parole, mais permettez-moi de dire, enfin, mes compliments
Merci.
à vous et à l'équipe d'auteurs. Hein, peu sont présents aujourd'hui, hélas, mais ils sont peut-être présents en ligne. Je ne sais pas si cette partie est diffusée. Oui, eh bien, à vous autres auteurs, hein, lointains en ce moment, absolument mes compliments pour ce qui vient de paraître aujourd'hui.
Okay, thank you. Here we are at the end of a really splendid 2 days, and I've been asked to give a bit of a review of this book, and I think it's often difficult to review a jointly written book. There's always lots of different things pulling in a way, but one of the nice things I noticed right away about the book, and then in reading through it, is that it's not just edited by Eloy Hordal in a way that you often see with just an introduction. He's also written a very good, useful resource at the beginning of each of the two parts. I think that I can echo the congratulations, really, in taking a subject that was fairly new to you, is the religious side, and doing quite useful summaries and surveys of the two parts. So the first part is about chapels, royal chapels, which I think have been written about before. And then the second part is a bit more innovative in looking specifically at convents and monasteries. And this is something that's particularly useful and relevant to the Spanish monarchy, and perhaps needs to then be explored more for other monarchies in Europe. Certainly the Habsburg studies in Vienna will have looked at a similar thing. French, I think medievalists have certainly looked at the relationship between the monarchy and monasteries, but I don't know of as many later 17th or 18th century connections, which maybe could be explored a bit more. And in England, we always have the problem, of course, that after the Reformation, that link is completely severed. So it would be interesting to explore what remaining things are connecting Stuarts or even Hanoverians to religion, to what's left of convents. I think there's a lot of interesting dimensions to pursue there. Even if you're thinking of using this for class, you know, for students, I think that those introductions that you wrote are quite useful. There's also a very useful glossary at the beginning, notes on currency, useful maps, very good illustrations. So I think overall, it's a nicely presented book. And I think Breppels has done a good job for doing that. There are a good deal of contributors to the book, to the volume, mostly Spaniards and Italians. And it covers quite an impressive range. So chapters range from Castile and Aragon, cities in Barcelona or Valencia, but also Palermo, a little bit on Brussels, but surprisingly, maybe given your background, there wasn't as much on the Spanish Low Countries. And then it's very nice to see some of the often forgotten parts. So there's a chapter on Sardinia, and there's a chapter on Lima, which is great. You know, more and more, I think we're realizing that the viceroys in South America were a really important part. Mm-hmm. So again, if this project had been expanded more, a chapter on Mexico City would have been good. And you mentioned Manila in your introduction, but I hadn't even thought of that. But so that's really great as well to remember. Manila also has its own Spanish court, its own presence. There are two themes that emerge very much from the book. One of them is the attempts to continue to integrate the different realms, as we've talked about a lot at this conference. And the other one, which comes apparent right away, is the persistent influence of Rome. And I think that's really important as well from the perspective of a non-Spanish historian or a non-Habsburg historian, because in other countries, the influence of Rome gets less and less and less. And in your book, you're saying that it's maintained or in fact increased in the 17th and 18th century. So I think that's an interesting thing to take away. And in particular, the dynastic identity of the Habsburgs is maintained as the primary supporter of the Roman Church. Which I guess flies in the face of the French king, who's always claiming to be, you know, the first son of the church, the first Christian prince. And in a way, the Spanish king is showing, well, this is actually how you do it. Not, you don't just say it, you do it. So what do we have more specifically? Part one, as I said, is about royal chapels. This covers Madrid, Palermo, Barcelona, and the chapter about Lima. And in particular, I think that there could have been a bit more influence here, like I said, about the Low Countries, but also there is a chapter about Portugal, but maybe it would have been good to have somewhat more reminder of the joint monarchy between 1580 and 1640. Second part then does have the chapter on Portugal and does have a chapter on the convent in Tervuren. So there is a Low Countries connection there. I think that there could be interesting parallels, not for this book so much, but other books in the future that do this same kind of thing, comparing dynasties and comparing connections to convents. The only one that really springs to mind to me as such a close relationship between dynasty and convents is Russia, really. And so I think the Romanovs are sometimes forgotten when we think about court culture, and the convents are such an important part of their court. And that might have been a very interesting, you know, when Peter the Great came west, did he come to Madrid? Does anybody know?
No, I don't think so.
No. I know he goes to London and he goes to Amsterdam, but it might have been interesting to see what he thought about Spain. So really to wrap up, I think to place this book in its wider context, we've seen a great revival of court studies since the late 90s, mid to late 90s. I think medievalists were doing it for quite a lot longer. And then 16th, 17th and 18th century studies began to come along. And we had large comparative volumes like the well-known book by John Adamson of Princely Courts of Europe, which I think was the starting point for a lot of people who set out on their PhDs at about this time. Then there were comparative volumes between, for example, Dindam's very well-known Vienna and Versailles. And since then, we've had quite a number of volumes like this one that do look specifically on aspects of court history. You mentioned the Hunting volume from 2006. And I noticed last night when I was looking around to see what's new, there's a brand new book that's just come out by Thomas Alson on Eurasian hunting. So comparing European with Asian royal hunt practices, which sounds really interesting and is certainly where our field is heading, is comparing on a more global scale. What do the European courts compare to Chinese or Indian? We've had very specific books about music. The book that was co-edited, last year by Anne-Madeleine Goulet and Mathieu Davigne, and music culture in all the various French royal sites. There's certainly been a number of books devoted specifically to gardens and garden history, and you're working on a project with that as well, currently.
Landscape, yes.
And so I think that's a nice development of the last 5 years of court studies, is bringing it outside of the palace, which has certainly always been your goal, mm-hmm. is to say it's not just about residences, it's not just about castles, but it's about so much more. And as we then maybe try to integrate these back into one whole, the musicians, the artists, the art historians, the architecture historians, the hunt historians, I think can then pull these things together into something nice. So I think that this book points towards the future of where our discipline is going. And so I congratulate you for putting it out. It's a very handsome book. And that's what I've got to say.
Eloy will now say something about his magnum opus in the name also of his co-authors.
Thank you very much for your kind presentation. Thank you very much for the Chateau de Versailles for hosting not just the conference, not have the chance to present this book here. And I think I was thought that was the best place for doing this kind of presentations, because as Jonathan has said right now, each time is more relevant and more necessary to do these comparative approaches. When I started with this project a long time ago, I speak a little bit about this after, it was my idea maybe try to compare the Spanish monarchy with other ones. But I realized that in this case, just with this will be enough. And still, like Jonathan has said as well, it is Mexico is not here. And luckily, the person who was in charge finally was not able to deliver the text. Naples, we miss Naples here, me too. We had the same problem. And Manila is one of the of this, when I was doing my research in during the lockdown, no, like we were, I was trying with Pares. It's crazy, we have that really good database, but I don't use that as much because I prefer to touch the DUCOM documents, not online or digital ones. And I realized that it existed a royal chapel in Manila, for example. And I have just taken one of the pages here, just you to for realize that, okay, there is a lot of work here, but still there are much more. That, for example, the Spanish monarchy, royal chapels were not just in Castile, that had royal chapels in Aranjuez, El Pardo, Sevilla, Córdoba, and Granada. But there were other territories, like, for example, the Codenberg Palace in the Habsburg Netherlands. There was another royal chapel in a palace we saw yesterday, the Paso da Ribeira in Lisbon. We had, for example, the Royal Palace of Naples, Palermo, Messina in Sicily, Lima in Peru, Mexico, Aljaferia in Aragon, for example, the Royal Palace in Aljaferia in Zaragoza, the Grand Royal Palace of Barcelona in Catalonia, the Royal Palace of Valencia, Cagliari, Sardinia, Manila. So in reality, what is relevant is that the Spanish monarchy was a monarchy of courts, different ones. We always say, still people have in mind that the court was Madrid, and it's not true. At least the Spanish monarchy was, I don't mind, I'm not going to speak about if composite or not. I know there is a long debate about that, but it's clear that it was necessary to study the different territories of the Spanish monarchy. And this, we always have heard that the Spanish monarchy had a close relation with the Holy See. And it's clear, of course, but the Holy See was not always the same policy. They didn't have the same policy. There were different groups, political and religious groups at that, no? So the link, the bond between the dynasty, the Habsburg dynasty, especially the women, with that it was clear. That's why I chose this picture we have here, no? A few years ago, I saw this picture that is not really well known. But I realized that she is Isabel Clara Eugenia, that this time is being more used, and a lot of people are speaking about her. So it's a great person that you don't understand why more than 20 years ago, nobody studied her together with the Archduke Albert. And even when they speak about the Archdukes, for me, it's really funny still, because Albert and Isabella were completely different in their policy, in their ideas, what they tried to apply it directly, no? And if you realize in the painting, of course, she's dressed like a nun, so it was a widow already. It was made by Jacob Jordaens after 1621, of course. And in the right, we can see a church. And on the left, it's not, we're going to see clearly here, the center, there is a staircase of a royal palace. Both of them didn't exist. They were created by Jordaens. But they represent quite clearly the double role that she had, the archduchess. So I start the book, one of these several texts I produce. I started with this, explaining this image. And in this image, we have every element of that. She was educated in Madrid, but she was then in the Habsburg Netherlands, and she got in contact with the Archduke Albert from Vienna, and even Albert was viceroy for 10 years in Portugal. So this mixture, how was expressed in the different convents or royal chapels. And it was great during the lockdown as well. I had to find this book, and I entered in contact with the owner. He's a really relevant person, has a lot of money, but he said that I have to put there a place that is American Private Collection, courtesy of Agnes Gallery, London. And he was really great, he was really kind, because he sent an image, said, just with this is okay, just send me an exemplar of the book, and that would be great. This idea started a few years ago, as I said a little bit a couple of days ago, through this conference in 2017. It was in York, the University of York. And in that moment, I had the great support by Cordula Fangwai. She was really interested in the topic, and we organized this conference at York because my idea, and it still is was to put the best specialists on a topic together, like we have done here, like we did in Utrecht, for example. And if you look at the name of the conference, Spanish Royal Geographies, no? So that's the moment where we started with these things, but especially focus in Habsburg politics and religion, this match between politics, piety, and religion. In that moment, we had the first schedule. From that first schedule, we finished a first draft of the book. And after speaking with Violette Soon, she is the editor of this Habsburg Worlds collection that Chris is going to speak about after. And they sent that to peer review. And as always happens with a peer review, when you receive this, it's okay. Okay. So I have to start again. And I have to rethink the book. And I have to start looking for more people from different spaces. But it was great after having that time, again, during the lockdown. We have a lot of time at home to think about these things. And I decided to split the book, not just in kingdoms, if not in these two parts, the royal chapels, the royal convents, and look for people that could match the different kingdoms that I miss in the whole one. So that's why I had to produce an introduction for the volume. And of course, the people from the peer review told me, you know, quite kindly, an introduction for the royal chapels, an introduction for the royal convents and monastery. And at the same time, what was more relevant, I didn't think about that, how, it's like the epilogue, how these ideas or the politics and piety that were devoted in these royal spaces all over the Spanish monarchy had influenced the relation with Rome and if did change something. And it's true. And what's clear is that the Pope always tried to influence in Madrid with the royal chapel and so on, but I could realize that he did the same, especially in two kingdoms, Valencia and the Habsburg Netherlands. And in the Habsburg Netherlands through Isabel Clara Eugenia. So some of the policy of the whole Spanish monarchy changed because of this, because of the relation they had, the kind of nuns they were there, the kind of religion, the kind of politics, the kind of piety they develop in all these spaces, no? So when I studied with the royal chapels, for example, is one of the studies that we had developed much more. For example, I spoke the other day that last year, together with Felix Labrador and other colleagues, we published the ceremonial of the royal chapel in Madrid. And I say yesterday, that ceremonial was developed by a Portuguese master of ceremonies, Manuel Ribeiro, but in the order that Philip III and then Philip IV gave him, he said you had to adapt this ceremonial of the Spanish Royal Chapel. You have to write a proper book, a proper ceremony, but you have to adapt this ceremony to the one of in Rome. Explicitly says that. Okay, so the idea of this person, Manuel Ribeiro, was working on this ceremonial and tried to match all these different parts. It's what José Martínez Millán has developed in the first chapter of this book, in the part related with the royal chapels. And at the same time, in that moment, I have to figure out that not everybody still realized, neither me at its moment, that the section of the royal household are not just one thing, a group of people. It's three different things. The first one, of course, is a group of people, no? The second one is a space, physical space, the royal chapel, the royal stables, the royal hand we was talking before. Which one is the space of the royal hand? The woods are the places where that people used to live. And in Madrid, it's quite clear. They used to live in a specific place in Fuencarral, and it was really relevant. There were a lot of other places that wanted to be like Fuencarral and to host all that people there, and the hounds, the dogs, and so on. And the third one, so we have the people that compose the royal household, we have the space, and we have the need of the king and his family. Which needs is here? Piety, spirituality, and how to implement that spirituality from the royal chapels, from the different kingdoms, to the rest of the people. Because that is another not really good idea related with the court studies. It's just elites. We are talking, studying just the elites. No, this was applied to the rest of the people through the trickle-down effect, like we saw yesterday, with these ideas, etc. And so with the representation of architecture, society, royal geographies, and so on. No, it started from the peak, of course, and then moved to the rest of society, territory, and so on. And in the second part, related with the convents and monasteries, it was clear for me, especially one thing, the pantheons. The royal pantheons are developed in the first chapter by Victor Minguez, for example, and in the one by Portugal, related with José Pedro Paiva, spoke about the use of some of these convents like royal pantheons, the continuing of the dynasty to show that. Of course, we have El Escorial. Everybody knows or need to know El Escorial, the monastery, I need to visit now that we can. But there were many others in many other places. And for example, in Sardinia, it's studied as well. How was one tomb that was used like that in connection always with the Habsburg dynasty? So the Habsburg didn't arrive to a place and try to change everything. They adapted what they had there to the needs they had. For example, in Lima, what is really well studied in the Royal Chapel in Lima. Okay, so of course, in every one of these books, you miss some things. I had written some of the chapters in a different way, but I am not the author. Okay, so that's why I try to match all this. And yes, I am agree with you. This is the kind of books that are doing in this moment, and we need to do this kind of books, not like we used to do before, that maybe mixing a lot of chapters, no real connection between that. We will speak about this after, no, in a few words. So there is a clear need to match all this and try to answer to one of these research questions like we are trying in this conference.
Thank you very much. And I take particular pleasure in presenting Christian de Borre, whose, well, not official title is Guardian Angel of Scientific Series at Brippels Publishers. He will speak to us about some of the relevant series, well, we are producing, actually, at his house.
Thank you, Christa. It feels very strange to be here. It feels actually very unnatural. For more than 18 months, we have all been hiding in our offices behind our screens, being trapped in endless Microsoft Teams and Zoom meetings, and finally now we can go out again. It is, for me personally, but also for Brepos, the very first conference that we are able to meet academics, to meet our authors again, to bring our books and present them to you. So it feels unnatural, but I'm very happy that we are able to start traveling again and to meet with all of you. I'm publishing manager at Brepels. I'm in charge of the Habsburg World series, but also the Architectura Moderna series and many others. But I will not talk about this series in specifically or about this book. I think that the previous speakers, I cannot do that better. They are the specialists. But I have chosen today to present two graphs to you that will shed some light on the editorial context at Brepels for the Habsburg World Series, but also the Architectura Moderna series. And the data that I have used to make these graphs are derived from our Brepolis medieval and early modern bibliographies. You can consult them at our website at brepolis.net. The first graph I would like to present shows the evolution of our publications by historical period over the last two, three decades. And more specifically, whether our books or articles are relevant or deal with the Middle Ages or with the early modern periods. And when we look at the first periods, we see that over 93% of our publications are deal with the Middle Ages. I think at that period, at that era almost, we can say that Brepols was almost synonymous for medieval research. But you see that gradually over the years, the share of early modern publications becomes more and more important. In the last years, almost 30% of our publications deal with the early modern period. And over that time, we also see that art history becomes more and more important in our catalog, with series like Pictura Nova, but also with series directed by Christa de Jong, Architectura Moderna, which was founded, if I remember correctly, 2002.
It's earlier.
Is it earlier? No, I think the first volume was published in 2002, yes, but of course our discussions go back earlier, of course. So you see that Brepols, there is a gradual evolution towards the early modern period, towards also art historical architectural topics. And the Habsburg World series is also part of that evolution. That series is much younger. The first volume was published, I think, 3-4 years ago. So that is the first graph I wanted to show you. The second graph looks at the language dimension and its evolution since 1995. When I talk to authors or potential authors, I always emphasize that Brepols is a true international publishing house. And what do I mean by that is that not only our markets are international, but also our authors are international. And more importantly, the languages we publish are very international. And you see that until 2014, approximately 50% of our publications are in English. Undoubtedly, English is the leading language. But unlike some other publishers, we do publish also other languages. And the second biggest language at Brepols is French. Its share has diminished a little, but until today, it is still a quarter of our publications that are being published in French. And the last 10% of our publications are Italian, Spanish, and German. So I think that when I say that Brepols is a true international publisher, it really means that we are able to serve you as an academic community, and giving our authors also the possibility and not force them to publish everything into English. I think that is also important today. And I think that is what it means to be an international publisher. These two graphs, and I'm finishing, have shed light on the specific editorial context in which the Habsburg World series was born, in which Architectura Moderna was born years ago. It demonstrates that we are progressing towards more early modern topics. And I think that is a very favorable context for the papers that have been presented today, but also in the past 2 days at this conference. Thank you.